The mysteries of the new season. You know, the key verse on the kingdom at the moment and on the lips of everything is Isaiah 43 that says God is doing a new thing. And when God says, I'm doing a new thing, it's a prophetic statement that he makes. It's a prophetic statement which I said had implications for us. And there's two main implications to take note of. And last week I dealt with the first one. Tonight I want to deal with the second one that flows so nicely into what Kari is sharing. So please stay with me. Listen, if you receive the word with your spirit, there's changes. And it's just because the Holy Spirit works with you and works with your faith. So don't sleep on me. Don't disengage. Don't daydream. But stay engaged. All right? Okay, so the first thing we said, God was challenging you and say, if I make this prophetic statement, I'm doing a new thing. God is saying, are you flexible enough to embrace the formula, a new formula that I'm releasing for breakthrough for you that you are not used to? And will you then still believe it's still from God? God says, are you flexible enough? Because not many of us is flexible. Are you flexible enough to embrace a new formula that you're not used to before and still believe it's God? God is challenging us. Do you have childlike faith? Can you maintain childlike faith? We are in the season where we have to be like children again, trusting the Lord. Throw aside all our baggage, all our grids of the last season, all our programming, all the things we think should have happened, not happened, all our abuses, all the stuff that tainted our canvas. And the Lord is saying, can you just trust me with childlike faith? Can you do that? So this is what the Lord said last week. So tonight, the second implication that we have to take notes of, the Lord is saying, be willing to receive and honor the prophetic. The prophetic. Be willing to receive and honor the prophetic. God says, when I say I will do a new thing, it tells you to prepare your spirit because the prophetic word, the prophetic of the Lord is coming into your life in this season and coming into your space. And when the Lord was saying that, it's all about what the Lord has spoken over your life in the past and what the Lord has spoken to you currently. And I spoke this morning, I said, you know, there's prophetic words in the Bible of people that, heroes of the faith that took 25 years to come into fulfillment, 20 years, 14 years, 15 years. There's heroes of the faith that's in the Hebrews 11 Hall of Fame that's mentioned there that had to wait pretty long time for God to break in and do what he has promised. So it's not unusual to wait. And God says, the thing is, the prophetic that the word has spoken, the words and the prophetic promises that God has spoken over you was maybe words that included rhema words that the Lord gave you in your own quiet time. You know, a rhema word is when a certain word jumps out from the logos to the rhema. The Holy Spirit highlights it. You dream about it. I remember, you know, the Lord can speak to you in dreams. I remember when my stepfather... before he died, quite a while before that, he had one night, he had a clear dream, and he was dreaming like he saw the blue of the sky, and across the blue, he just saw the scriptures, Ezekiel 37, and it was about the dry bones coming to life. And it was a clear prophetic picture, God speaking to you, giving a prophetic promise. Of course, we go and interpret it the way we want to, and God was faithful. And the Lord touched him and eventually died. But the Lord really caused his spiritual bones, had an encounter with him. He eventually had cancer. And, you know, you think in your mind there's going to be a restoration. The person is going to live. God's going to restore him and all the other ways that he's trusting for years. But he died eventually. But in that process of the cancer, he met the Lord for the first time in an authentic, dimensional way where the hardness left, the resistance, the stubbornness left. You know, and he drove all over the Western Cape and in the area, you know, going to see people that he needs to make right with. And you know, and the Lord came and really resurrected him spiritually. And the day that he died, because my mother always prayed and said, Lord, the greatest gift you can give me if you bring my husband in to a level where he's on fire for God and that he has an encounter with the Lord. So as the Lord is faithful, he died on her birthday, which was a gift. And as he died the morning at home, one of the ladies that went to the same church as my mom, she lived in the same complex, and she came that morning, didn't know he died. And she told my mother, I'd come to knock at the door. I just want to tell you I had a dream last night. And I saw your husband, he was already sick, she knew, but I saw your husband walking tall and healthy and smiling and laughing. And she said, he just died this morning. And I knew that when the God spoke a promise, It was something that was prophetic, and it was a promise that he made. And it has a dimension where the prophetic word, with the promises of God, either if you had a dream or if a prophet gave you a word of God, gave you a rhema scripture, and you're in your quiet time and you saw in the scriptures, oh, this is the Holy Spirit speaking to me. Who knows what I'm saying? It jumps out of you. Just know God gave you a promise. So God can speak to you and give you a promise in any way that he can. But that is a prophetic word of the Lord that's in the Spirit. The seed for your breakthrough is in that word. The seed for your breakthrough is in that word, because it's something that's spoken into the atmosphere that has not manifested yet. Speak things as if they are and they're not. They're not yet. And that's what the word is. So God gives you a word or a promise. It has got a seed of the breakthrough is in the word. And as you start prophesying and speaking that word and working with that word and speak life over that seed, it develops in the Spirit and it forms your breakthrough. It forms the promise. It forms the door. It forms the deliverance, the breakthrough that you need. Because the seed that is in, what if you curse the seed? What if you speak negative about it? What if you say, well, I don't think, you know, it's been 20 years, 30 years, it's not going to happen. You speak death over it. What happens to that seed? How can you resurrect the seed and ask the Lord to germinate it again? Maybe you've forgotten about the death that you have spoken over your own promises. In times when you were low, in times when Athaliah surrounded you, when you were besieged, or whatever happened. So tonight I want us to revisit that and ask the Lord for a turnaround. To reverse the transactions that we ourselves have brought about in our lives to block our own seed that's in that word. Because at times we just say ridiculous things. And we've spoken death over our own seed. Under the beguilement of Jezebel, under the beguilement of Athaliah, whatever they get you to seduce you, to say, well, you know, I'm not going to do this, or I'm going to do, or, you know, those vows and those stuff, that nonsense that you speak when you're in emotional turmoil. Couples that are sitting here, married couples, sometimes you have to pray for people and they need to repent, because we see the words hanging of divorce, or see the words hanging that people speak when they're angry. And then they kiss up and they're all fluffy and everything, but the words are still in the atmosphere, and the enemy works with that to create a case for separation and divorce in the future. So words have prophetic significance. It carries seed for the future. It creates. So we need to deal with these things properly. And we need to dust off some stuff and pray for activation over some prophetic stuff that the Lord has released into our life. Prophetic dreams, prophetic words, rhema words. Because God says, part of this, I'm doing a new thing. It's about the prophetic. That thing was spoken into the atmosphere that's coming and getting some legs and body and coming into your space and into your atmosphere. Do you have that? Yeah. So this is important, because the prophetic is a factor that creates. God designed it. It is a spiritual thing that God says, are you like me? You speak a word, I prophesy a word, and it is life. It creates. So we can create death and life with our own mouth. It's really serious. With your mouth you condemn, with your mouth you can be justified, the Bible says. And we have to be so careful. So prophetic is a factor that creates. And the prophetic word is responsible for the manifestation of spiritual things. It is the driving force. Like I said, the seed is in that. So I want to say to you, you know, when we last week, I said to you, the Bible said when Abram and Isaac, when Abram and Sarah, it was a time for Isaac to be born. I mean, they had the word for 25 years. The Bible said God graciously remembered Sarah. Remember, God remembered Sarah. I mean, 25 years. Thank you, Jesus. There comes a time when God remembers, and the Bible says, and he visited Sarah as he said he would. And he fulfilled the promise as he promised, or he gave them the child as he promised. Doesn't matter how long it takes, but it was a manifestation of the word. It was a manifestation of a word that was spoken, and the seed germinated and it manifested into their hands. So we have to open our heart when God speaks to us, to be open to any formula God chooses to use in your life in this new season. I'm challenging myself. I said, Kari, I hope I'm not too old and too, you know, old mindsets, maybe because of our age, to miss a new move of God, to miss it if God does something new. That's my challenge. Because if something is maybe God and it's new and I don't like it because it doesn't fit into my paradigm, I might abort it. I might miss a Kairos moment. I might miss a window of opportunity that God opens for me because I don't recognize it. I miss it. So I said, Lord, please help me that I'll not recognize the formula that you're going to come into and kind of visit me with. And if it's out of my paradigm, let me discern that it's you, that I'll don't miss it. And God really does anything the Bible says before he speaks to his prophets. Not true? That's what the Bible says. So the word says it's the Spirit and the bride that says come. Who's the bride? Us. The Bible says it's the Spirit and the bride that says come. It's not the Spirit alone. What does that mean? That means the bride must echo what the Spirit of God is saying. So if the Spirit of God is saying something, the bride must echo it and come in agreement, because both must say come for the word to manifest. Okay, so the prophet comes, Kari comes and say, the Holy Spirit is saying to you, there's going to be, Deborah, there's going to be breakthrough. The Lord says within 24 hours, your life's going to change incredibly. There's going to be shifts and changes that's going to make, send you, God has heard your prayers and there is a door opening in the next 24 hours that's going to make you stand amazed. All right. Okay, that's the word. So we speak that word, but the Bible says the bride and the Spirit must say come. So if the Spirit of God speaks that word, there must be a man on earth that can execute that word, and a representative on the earth realm that can bring that word down from heaven to earth. It's our job to negotiate and to bring the words down, to cause heaven to come down to earth. It's our job. It's not God's job. So whatever the Spirit is saying, somebody on earth must echo that and bring it down in the realm of the Spirit, and bring it down and legislate it down into the earth. We are heaven's law enforcers. You enforce the word. You enforce the word that God's spoken. You force. Nobody's going to do it for you. You don't enforce the word. Nothing's happening. Because it's the Spirit and the bride that says come. So if the Spirit releases the word and the bride does nothing, there's no activation of the word. You understand that? Hannah the prophetess prayed for Jesus to come to the earth. Hannah prayed. She interceded for Jesus. There was a prophetic intercession and a birthing that came from that woman. Hannah. I said Hannah. Hannah. Ach, whatever. Anna, tomato. No. I'm sorry. It's not tomato. Anna. Sorry. I had 9 sessions before I arrived here. Okay. Anna. I tell you that. Anna. Hannah. There was a Hannah, but it's not. The H break off, so it was Anna. He prayed so much, the H broke off. It's in the church. And now she's Anna. I'm sorry. Okay, Anna and Hannah. Okay, Anna, the prophetess, prayed for Jesus to come to earth. Somebody interceded, a human face, an agent in this side of the kingdom of heaven in the earth realm, partnered with the Spirit, and it brought down, because it's the bride and the Spirit that must say, come. If there's not an intercessor or a person that can negotiate and bring down what the Spirit is saying, there's no manifestation. No manifestation. That's why we must pray, war over our prophetic words, speak it out, because that's part of the spiritual rules of engagement. Jesus prophesied his own valid prophetic word. Can you believe it? That he would rise within 3 days. And it happened. So prophecy could be rhema scriptures that the Lord gives you. It could be your personal prophetic revelation. But there has to be a voice in this realm, in this domain, on this side of God's kingdom that will echo what the Spirit is saying. You have to. It's important. This is a formula. It is the Spirit and the bride that must say come. Look at Ezekiel 37. Remember the story about the dead bones. All right? The dead bones did not come alive because God was speaking. What did God say? Son of man, do you think the bones can come alive? First step. So God is asking, do you think your marriage can come alive? Do you think I can resurrect your business? Do you think I can touch your marriage? Do you think I can touch your finances? Do you think you can survive this cancer? Whatever is dead in you, do you think that? So when Ezekiel the prophet gave his agreement and says, yes, Lord, I do believe. There was an agreement. Then the next step, God says, now, son of man, you prophesy. And it's the Spirit that was saying, and God didn't prophesy for it. He told Son of Man, you prophesy. And there was a divine agent between heaven and earth in the earth realm. It's until man in the earth realm began to speak what God says and follow prophetic instruction until there was a manifestation. So I want to say to you, that's why God says, speak to your mountain and it will be cast into the sea. If you just have a little bit of a mustard seed, faith. Speak to your mountain. What is mountain? It's impossibilities. It is stuff that is raised up and blocking you. God says, speak to your mountain. So, oh my goodness, what a strange religion is this. What is the mountain? Where is the mountain? No. The mountain is things that raise up against you. Stuff that blocks you. Impossibilities. Difficulties. God says you take the word. You speak to your situation. And God says it will move. Not might possibly. And you just need a little bit of mustard seed. The level of faith doesn't have to be much. But the power of your words and speaking from heaven down to earth, saying what God is saying, has a powerful effect to bring manifestation and change into your life. I just know, unfortunately, there's been a lot of abuse of the prophetic, as you know, ministry in many churches. Jezebel is really much to blame for that. And many people and ministries have thrown out the baby with the bathwater. I know a lot of churches that hate the prophetic because of bad experiences. People that were Jezebelic that used prophetic for manipulation and, you know, prophesied for money. And, you know, it was a whole witchcraft thing and a lot of manipulation. And they just threw out the baby with the bathwater. But it's such an important part and system. And because the system has been corrupted, it does not mean there's no authentic dimension of it. We're trying to keep it so pure in this house. And I'm always so thankful to the Lord when people, even after 10 or 12 years or 20 years, when we walk somewhere, people come to me and say, just tell your wife that word that she gave me 20 years ago has come to pass or whatever. I just had such a lot of testimonies. And I just say, we need that feedback to know that God downloads word accurately to us and we speak the word of the Lord. So there's an authentic dimension that we want to steward for the Lord. To help people to understand that, to understand God's heart, and to bring the prophetic with the love of Jesus Christ and with the power of reconciliation and love. And it's not an easy thing if you're in a deliverer or a warfare ministry. But I believe we make it sound easy. Not true. No. Okay. Not that bad. All right. We're not old warriors with like, okay. Anyway. And listen, we need the prophetic word. We need the prophetic of the Lord. We need those words because the Bible says the church is built on the apostolic and the prophetic. So a healthy ministry and a healthy church structure, when you build it, has to be on the foundation of the apostolic and the prophetic. That's how it works. The fact that other people abuse it or it's got a bad name doesn't mean God doesn't want it there. So we are built on the foundations of the apostolic and the prophetic with Jesus Christ as the cornerstone. That's how a healthy ministry should look like. And be built. All right, so we need to do the authentic thing. Listen, but the prophetic words, when a prophet releases a prophetic word, it can activate a season over your life. Do you know that? Jeremiah 1, the Bible says the prophetic ministry has got so much power, it can uproot, demolish, and overthrow things in your life, pull out the weeds, and plant the kingdom. So the Bible have used prophets. John the Baptist was prophetic, and he announced Jesus. He said, "Jesus, this is the Son of God." And he baptized him and he ushered Jesus into a new season. Jesus was finished with his city as a preparation. When it's a new season, he got baptized. John the Baptist announced it. The heavens opened. There was a prophetic shift over Jesus. It activated a new season of display and visibility and public ministry for Jesus. It was the prophetic that shifted things in the spirit. I promise you, when a prophet speaks a word over you, it shifts things over your life. It can shift you literally that the person can say the next day, listen, there was things opening up for me. I remember the one guy that you ministered, that you prophesied, it was a visitor two Sundays ago. It was about a financial thing. Literally 2 days after that, I think he got the biggest amount that they ever got from some deal. And I just know it's because the power of the prophetic word that comes from God. If it's a word, not from your flesh, but from the Spirit of God, there's power behind it to shift things in the Spirit, to bring an uprooting, a shift and a change for a manifestation and an activation. That's really powerful. And the prophetic dimension spoken, a true word from the Lord can activate things over your life and really shift it because of the power of the Holy Spirit backing it up. It doesn't matter. For me, it doesn't matter. Maybe you can agree with me. It doesn't matter how God does the new thing. But the important thing is for me that he does a new thing. And many people worry and think and try to figure out how he's going to do it. Not your problem. God will do it his way. You just come and you position yourself and prophesy to yourself, thank you, Lord, that God is doing a new thing in my life. All right, can we decree that? Say, Lord, thank you.
Lord, thank you.
I declare and decree and I prophesy over my life. Lord, do a new thing. Do a new thing. Do a new thing in my life. In the name of Jesus. You are the prophet of your own destiny. So what the Lord has spoken to you through His Spirit that's authentic, I'm not talking about the pizza dreams and the pizza words and the funny bunny stuff, but the words that the Lord has given you, there's like a golden thread. You know, this is authentic works of the Lord. It's been confirmed. You war with that and you pray that into being in existence, and there will be a manifestation if you keep on praying, keep on pushing, because there's an appointed time for that word to manifest. Because God works in time and space, in certain seasons. There's other stuff that needs to come into the equation to make the word work. So don't get discouraged when you keep on prophesying and nothing's happening, because there's other factors you're not aware of that needs to come in to that factor to make the word manifest. But God is faithful in the name of Jesus. So I want to mention, I'm going to mention three examples from Scripture that reveals the dynamics of converting the old to the new through the power of the prophetic. Who knows that when a prophet of somebody, it can just be somebody that releases the word of the Lord. That's an authentic word from the Spirit. If that's being decreed, it can really shift you in a totally dimensional shift your life. The first example where the power of the prophetic was used to shift people from the old to the new. And you know, we are a prophetic ministry and we do a lot of prophetic decrees, a lot of prophetic word, a lot of things that we are speak. Even when I teach, I release prophetic stuff. Those words have power to come and break things off your life. You know, yeah, to what? To transform you and cut things. And it's like a sword. And if you receive and you say, yes, that's for me, then immediately there's an exchange. The first example, 2 Kings 5. You know the story of Naaman and the guy, Naaman who had the leprosy. He was a Syrian commander, and the Bible says he was amazing, he was good looking, he was fantastic, he was prominent, and everything was going for him, but he had leprosy. And Naaman was a guy in the army, and he had this terrible problem of leprosy, and it was a thing that could eventually kill you and a despicable thing. So we see in the Bible, at that time Elisha was a territorial prophet ruling over the spiritual territory of Israel. He had some of the grace that he carried actually ruled over a whole territory. That was the type of grace that he has prophetically. That means when God gives you that grace, one prophet can make a decree and it will shift the whole thing over a region. Okay? A lot of prophets have God has anointed them to have territorial grace to rule a spiritual region spiritually. And that's why you say, oh goodness, this woman just came and stand on the mountain and made one decree, and there the whole cookie crumbles or whatever. Things are coming down strongholds. So God wanted to do a new thing for Naaman in his life. And it's so amazing, God's love. This guy's not even in covenant with God. He was just, you know, God was just displaying his power and his goodness to this guy. And he wanted to do a new thing in his life. But this guy did not have the flexibility to embrace God's formula that God wanted to use. Do you know the story? Let's do it quickly. God used the divine connection, which is the Hebrew maid in his house, okay? So don't look down on your maid or the people that working around you. God can use a donkey. God can use anybody to usher you into a new season. And this guy was strong and powerful, and God didn't use a doctor and the best physician. He used the maid in his house to be a divine connector and a divine helper to connect him to his breakthrough. So you must be wide awake and open your ears and open your eyes for people around you. See, where's the divine connectors that God and divine helpers that God has placed around you? It could be unusual ones. So if your dog speaks to you, don't think it's weird, okay? Don't think I need to go off my medicine and my pills, all right? Because I'm hallucinating, all right? God used a donkey. It's possible. I don't know. You know, so be open to a new formula. And he was so upset and offended. Why was he upset? Because this maid says, I know a prophet who can help you. So he was desperate to get healed. And he came to Israel. And when he came to the prophet's house, he knocked on the door. And the formula that the Lord released was as follows. The Lord gives Elisha a remedy and a formula to heal this guy. He says, now the problem is, this guy is a prominent guy in the Syrian army. He's used to people treating him with respect and honor. So Elisha says, I'm in a meeting. Just tell him. He needs to go and wash himself 7 times in the muddy, dirty Jordan River. Doesn't even come out to give the message himself. This Syrian, Naaman, was so offended. How dare this guy? Who does he think he is? Doesn't even send a messenger to tell me that. And I'm not going to wash myself in the dirty river. You know who I am. He was angry because of the instruction and the perceived attitude of Elisha. But he didn't realize that this was a prophetic instruction that God gave him, a new formula that will give him healing. And because of his lack of discernment and the danger of his tradition, he was about to miss his divine moment of opportunity where God wants to give him a new thing. Because tradition says it has to happen in this way. Why? Don't come with your funny stories and revelation to me now. When the prophet tells you, God tells you, run around the building 5 times and jump in the pond. What are you going to say? Bye, Felicia. I'm not doing that. What's going on with you? I'm not doing that. What's the funny stuff is this? That could be a prophetic instruction and God is just testing you. You know, it depends. So what is rising up to block it? And this guy had no spiritual discernment. And because of tradition, it blocked him. He said, well, this is absolutely ridiculous. And he didn't even know what the background of the prophet Elisha was. That was quite interesting to me. Elisha did not become a prophet by destiny. I never knew that. But it was his hunger that made him a prophet. I want to say to you, some of you could have a prophetic gifting or a lower level, whatever, or maybe have something else. But if you are hungry for something, if you're hungry for a spiritual gifting, if you're hungry for the things of God, God can give you the ultimate. And he was hungry because he was not supposed to be a prophet. He was a farmer. The next prophets in that time should have come from the sons of prophets, the sons of the prophets. You can read about it. But the sons of the prophets, the problem is their familiarity and their dishonor closed the door for them. And many times we're in the ministry and we're around another prophet or a senior prophet, and there's familiarity and there's dishonor, it shuts the door for you to receive further from that person, or God shuts the door for you to be elevated through that anointing and through that office. I remember one lady one time, she's passed on now, you know, when we came into the meeting and she said to Corey, I'm a little pumpkin. I said, well, you know, if she's the pumpkin, then you're going to get the pumpkin's reward. But if you receive from the prophet, you get the prophet's reward. All right, so I'm just joking. I'm just saying sometimes, even with yourself, each one of you, we need to recognize you by the Spirit. You need to recognize people around you, what they carry. Don't look at them from the outside and thought, oh my goodness, you know, whatever. You must recognize each other by the Spirit, what you carry. Even if the person is your BFF and your best friend, have respect for one another, for what you carry by the Spirit. When you have honor and respect, not only for us as leaders, but for your friends and the people around you, you will always receive from what is on their life. But familiarity breeds contempt, and familiarity causes you to have an attitude where you later on can't receive from them. You're not going to tell me what to do because of familiarity. Because when the prophet says, I'm giving you an instruction, I'm not going to do what you tell me to do. Because prophetic instruction is to avoid destruction. But familiarity makes you don't want to receive from the person because you view them now as their friends and dishonor. So what happens is those guys that were in line for the prophetic got blocked because of their attitude. But Elisha followed the prophet Elijah relentlessly and tenaciously. Elijah said to him, tick, you know, in Cape Town we say that. go, leave me alone. Go, 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 go. It's a nice tick, tick. You know, it's a nice word too. In South Africa, we mean it's, yeah. Goodbye. Goodbye, yeah. Anyway, I laugh when they say it, the till tick of spar. When you swipe the card, tick of spar, check, check. Okay, so he said, go, I don't want you. I don't want you. Leave me alone. He said, I'm not leaving you. I'm sticking to you. I'm clinging on to you. And because of his tenacity and his humility, following Elijah, I got a double mantle. So when you're tenacious and you're hungry to receive from the Lord and learn from your leaders and receive what and get what is on their lives, there's a reward. I want to say to you, if God can change a nation in a day, He can definitely deal and change your situation. We're in a season where God says, okay, and you see, nations are going to be born in a day. We're moving to a macro level where God is moving and shifting to that dimension. Don't you think God can sort out your situations? Definitely. And Naaman had such offense. He said, no, why don't you just call on the name of your God and let's sort it out that way? Because he was used in his culture and his idol worship, you call on the name of the Lord. That his tradition. So the formula that God wanted to give him to heal him, he blocked it because of tradition. And then he was offended and said, why must I go and bathe in this filthy rivers? Why can't I go and dip myself in the lovely rivers of Damascus? And when God is doing a new thing, we can't come with our own terms and dictate to God or to the prophet. You must be flexible to receive. We do not get to edit the prophetic instruction that were given to us. Because like Kari says, the prophetic instructions to avoid destruction. And I remember one time, well, this guy was probably stubborn and full of pride. And he was a public official. Can you think the embarrassment to go and dip yourself in a dirty river? Not open to what God wants to do. Tradition blocked him. His programming blocked him. Just call on your God and let's just do it right here, you know, quickly. I don't want to do what you want to tell me to do. We don't get to edit God's prophetic instruction. God tests our obedience. And I just remember one time when somebody called us that we knew and she said, can you come and pray for this couple, myself and Kari? We went to the lady's house. We didn't know them from a bar of soap. And Kari always says she doesn't know why. When she prays for people, she can see who's tithing and not tithing because they open in the spirit. So it's not her fault that she sees that. How must she know that? We don't even know that person. And this person was, when we started praying for them, the gentleman got so offended because he hates tithing and he talks against tithing. But his life is in shambles and he's financially in a place where he shouldn't be. And when she said, but I saw, you know, we didn't know the background, but Mikari prophesied and said, well, do you tithe? Because the Lord shows me you open in the spirit and there's no protection. And the Lord's saying that you're not tithing and you should tithe. And there was such a manifestation. And he resisted it because that's one of his principles that he used to war against and say, well, you know, whatever is going on, it's not because of that. I don't believe in that. I was like, but how would the Lord show it to me? I don't even know you. So many times God gives prophetic instructions and people resist it because of their belief system, their background, their pride, and their stubbornness. But it's the very key that can break them out of the thing. So this is one of the things that God many times uses things in our life to conquer our fears, to make us pass through it instead of taking it away from it. Who of you have already prayed many times, God, just take this cup from me. Just take this away from me. Let it just go away. And the most of the times, God takes you through it to conquer your fear of lack of finances, your fear of whatever you have. And that God takes you through it to conquer your fear and not necessarily take it away from you. So Naaman was angry and he said, well, bye, Felicia, I'm out of here. I am not going to do this. And he was, I mean, the strong man operating through his bloodline was controlling him so much, he went into a fit, into a rage. Because the demonic spirits that they worship obviously didn't want him to get healed. So he went in a rage and he went away. And I thought to him, where are you going? You know, where are you going? And obviously, because of his rage, he said, I'm going back to yesterday. I'm going back to my past. You know, if this is what it's going to take to have a new thing, I'd rather keep my pride and go back to yesterday. And God's mercy and grace is so displayed in this way because as he was turning around and saying, what you're asking for me for my healing is too much. I'm going to stick with my pride and I'm going to go and stay in the place that I was. His workers and the guys, the servants that served him started begging him, please, Naaman, please, I beg you, please reconsider, you know. And they begged him and begged him and begged him and until he said, okay. You know, he obviously cooled down and he said, okay, I'm going to try it. And they convinced him. And it was God's mercy using them again to persuade him. And I think God wanted to not only heal him but also destroy his ego. Dipping him in the river as healing but also destroying the pride and the ego. And because of the ego that he had, he didn't want to go and bathe in the dirty Jordan because he felt, you know, it's going to be a public disgrace. I'm not going to do that. And the prophet said, dip yourself seven times. And only after the seventh time, when the process is completed and you've been obedient through the whole process, there will be a manifestation. And many times God gives us the instruction, and only when you've done the whole instruction, there's a release and there's a manifestation after the process is completed. Partial obedience is no obedience. Partial obedience is no obedience. And the writers are actually saying the reason why Elisha asked him to dip seven times, because the curse that came into his generational line that gave him leprosy came in seven generations ago. The Jordan River is a generational river. So God is prophetic. And that's why I said, go and dip yourself seven times. So every time he dipped it, it was for one generation redeeming. And when he, after the seventh generation, the curse was broken, he came out with baby skin totally healed. And God didn't do it because he was nasty. There was prophetic significance in it. And this guy's pride was buried and his ego was buried in the river with the leprosy. Because leprosy sometimes is not only physical stuff, it's spiritual stuff. The ugly stuff that people can see from the outside. And when the glory of the Lord manifests in our reveal is because we have kept God's patterns and we have followed his processes that he has wanted us to do. And when the glory of God comes and manifests, it is almost like a receipt that we get that we have followed in obedience to what the Lord wanted us to do. And his battle with leprosy, the healing of that came from a prophet's mouth. The instructions in the name of Jesus, and that shifted the whole thing. The second story, second example, how to convert the old to the new season through the power of the prophetic. I'm going to be quick. 2 Kings 7. This was the story about the besiegement of Samaria. Do you remember the story? The Assyrian army besieged the city, and there was no supernatural supply. They were hungry, they were inside, no food left at the end of the day. And in this story, we saw a miracle of supernatural supply through the word of the prophet. And it was at this worst where there was no food left. They were eating each other's children. And the prophet Elijah pop up from nowhere and he prophesies, hear the word of the Lord. Tomorrow, this time, the whole famine is going to be broken. There's going to be overflow. So much that you're going to vomit the food through your noses and through, I don't know what, it was a total overstatement. And he prophesied that, and he said, tomorrow this time, this is going to happen. And we see the Bible says the captain of the king's guard suddenly rose up when he gave the prophetic word and says, listen, I just want to say to you that pride and arrogance and religion and tradition rising up, even if God opens the windows of heaven, it will not be enough to save the city. And Elisha prophesied to him and says, as I prophesy the breakthrough, I prophesy judgment over you. And you will see the breakthrough, but you'll not taste it. And as we know what happens, that prophecy of the prophet worked in the realm of the spirit and shifted and changed and triggered and broke the besiegement and shifted the whole atmosphere and positioned in the realm of the spirit through the power of the prophetic word, a whole narrative to change. Can you remember what happened? The story is, because of the prophetic word, the spirit of prophecy arrested four lepers who sat outside of the gate. And as the prophecy went out, it shifted the things in the spirit. The spirit of prophecy arrested them. And in the realm of the spirit, in the realm of their soul, the word came to swirl around them. And they started talking. And God took the prophetic word and put an unction and a burden on them. And they start talking and say, listen, either we die of hunger or we die of leprosy or we just die because the Syrian camp is just here. So let's rather go and go to our enemies and get it over and done with. And the Bible says, as they went to the camp, there was no one there. All the Syrian armies have left. Why? Because God is powerful. God is almighty. He's powerful. He's smart. God used the Syrian army's imagination to defeat them. Their imagination to defeat them. In the spirit, they heard a noise that sounded like an army that's coming. And I thought, oh my goodness, the king of Samaria has probably got the help of the king of Egypt. And there's lots of armies. Let's run for our lives, you know. And they ran. imagination. The Lord can come and manipulate your enemy's imagination to feel things and believe things and have the fear of God upon them, that they will run for their lives. They left the camp just like that, and the four lepers came there. All the stuff was there, and the whole prophetic word manifested, and the besiegement was broken, and all they got all the spoils in the name of Jesus. I can't read that. In Jesus' mighty name. Jesus' mighty name. I want to say to you, this is powerful. When God gives you a plan, when God gives you a strategy and a recipe, it is absolutely powerful. And the last example, 2 Chronicles 20. The king Jehoshaphat came and he was the king of Israel. Three nations came to make war against him. He prayed and says, Lord, what is your war strategy from your war room in heaven? I can do the normal strategy, getting our weapons, getting all our army guys together. But what is your strategy? Hear what the Lord is saying. What is the formula? Guys, let gather a lot of worshipers, get the army ready, and let the worshipers go before the army and let them sing, praise the Lord, his mercy endures forever. Praise the Lord, may his mercy endures forever. Praise the Lord, may his mercy endures forever. And as they walked in front, and as they made prophetic decrees and prophetic proclamations, declaring God's greatness, worshipping, praising, God sent ambushments against the enemy. What an interesting strategy. What an interesting formula to win the victory. And the victories was won through the power of the prophetic. Because I wouldn't think I'm going to win my enemies by getting some worshippers together and let them run, march in front of the army, making prophetic decrees about God's greatness. But that shifted the atmosphere and God defeated the enemies. You see, we're in a season where we're going to possess new things, new doors, new opportunities, new land, new spiritual ground, and God's going to dispossess our enemies. Because it's a season where God says, I'm giving you the enemies in your spheres of influence and in your boundaries that I've ordained for you. I'll take them out. You just get the strategy, decree it, and I'll do the dispossessing. I'll kick them out. This is what's going to happen, and this is what's happened. And they took 3 days alone to get the spoil out of that camp. I mean, God gave them rest on all sides. God released fear upon their enemies. And just because of this strategy, isn't this amazing? So God says, behold, I'm doing a new thing in your finances, in your family, in your relationships, in your partnership, in your marriage. God says, I'm doing a new thing. And I remember in Luke 5, when the disciples were tired from catching fish in the night, they couldn't fetch anything. You remember that? Couldn't fetch anything. And Jesus came onto the scene and says, no, but throw the nets in on the other side. They said, we are so tired after the season. And they did it in the night, which is prophetic of a night season, a difficult season. And they said to Jesus, only on the account of your word, I will do it. So I want to say to you, are you prepared to throw in your nets? Are you prepared to put in your nets? Are you prepared to trust the Lord again for that word? Only on the account of his word. It is a new season. It is a new time. The night is gone. The morning is breaking. And God says, in that very place where you've battled, God says it's a new grace, a new anointing, and what couldn't work before is going to work now. But do it only on account of God's word, if that's the only thing that you do. God says, I'm going to give you a testimony that's not been recorded in your family line, in your lives. It will not be a testimony of anything that you've had before. It's going to be brand new testimonies. And God says we need to start and pray and decree our prophetic promises, the Rhema words that God has given us. Go and brush it off. Write it down. God says, I want you to start speaking life over them. Start decreeing them. Working with the Spirit to bring forth the birth of these words. The stuff that you've spoken death over, that seed will come alive again as you activate the promise of God. Because it is the Spirit and the Bride that says, come. And God says, I can use you to activate and speak life over the dry bones and breathe life over the seed in that prophetic word to come alive. And God will do it in an instant and an acceleration in the season in Jesus' mighty name. Amen and amen. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. So I really feel it's a key in this season. So I want us to pray about that. Is that all right? And I want you to think anything that the Lord has spoken to you. If you haven't received the prophetic word ever in your life, the Lord is speaking, haven't spoken to you ever, you need to engage with the Lord because he wants to give you prophetic words. He wants to draw near to you. He wants to give you promises. And God speaks to us. So I want you to come and as we take up the offering, and you should come and sow something. Just say, Lord, I'm going to I'm sowing the seed as we're going to pray for a reactivation of my words. I've heard many people speaking death over their words, canceling some stuff, speaking death over because of the power of presumption, disappointment, disappointment in God's timelines, disappointment in their circumstances, and such a lot of things that the enemy has come to beguile us with. So God is saying, I want you to come and revisit those words that you know was from me and start prophesying afresh over it with the Spirit of the Lord for a manifestation. If you know that you have put some stuff on the shelf, take it off and reactivate the seed that is dormant and prophesy to the dry bones and to the Spirit of God to breathe over it. Resurrection power in Jesus' mighty name. Please, you can come to the front. Let's come and take up the offering. Come, you can come. Here's the baskets. And as you walk, let it be a prophetic act of faith. Let it be a prophetic action of faith. And say, Lord, as I walk, because faith without actions means nothing. There's an activation. So, Father, as we come tonight and as we take up the offering, as there's a sowing, Lord, and a seed, sowing of the seed on this altar, I pray, Father, as we pray now that there will be a fresh activation of the prophetic promises of God over this people under this anointing and under this house in the name of Jesus. Lord, this is a prophetic house with a prophetic stream. We value, Father, the power of the prophetic. You know, Father, we walk in that power, Lord. We have seen the power of the Holy Spirit as it comes upon us and backups the word, and we see, Lord, that when the Spirit of God speaks and we execute, there is a transfer and a power. So, Lord, I thank you right now. Even every prophetic word, every promise, Lord, that is dead, that people have shelved, that people have spoken death over, that people have forgotten because of disappointment and discouragement, I pray tonight in the name of Jesus that as we pray that will come alive, that you resuscitate every word and promise, Father, by agreement, by the power of the Holy Spirit. And Lord, that the Spirit of God will come and resuscitate and resurrect those seeds and those promises, Lord, that you've given us. Thank you, Lord. Let's just stand. We're going to pray quickly. Thank you, Lord. I want you to just stir up your faith. And may the Holy Spirit come and remind you of any words that the Lord has given you. Abram waited 25 years. His son waited 20 years. Joseph waited 14 years. David, 15 years. It's not unusual for you to wait. But the Bible says there come a times when God remembers. When does God remember? When we start reminding Him. The Bible says, remind me of my promises. Not because God can't remember or we can't hear. Because there's an activation that happens when you pray it back to Him. Because it's the Spirit and the Bride that says, come. And there's a divine activation to happen. Like it happened with Ezekiel. Are we ready? It's not going to be a long prayer, but we're going to trust the Lord. Father, we thank you tonight. And we ask forgiveness for every place and in every season where we have persecuted or rejected your true prophets and the true prophetic words that came from the Spirit of the Lord over my life. Lord, I ask forgiveness for any pride, any stubbornness, any arrogance that I've displayed against you, against your prophets, because I didn't understand the timelines, the word, what you were doing. Lord, because I moved in presumption. I ask forgiveness, Lord. I ask forgiveness. I repent for any wrong attitude. I humble myself tonight under your mighty hand. And I say, Lord, I realize that you are true to your word, that you are serious about covenant. And Lord, I don't want to stand in the way of my words and my stuff of the past that I've spoken death over. I cancel every word of death that I've spoken over true prophetic words that were spoken from the mouths of prophets over my life that came from your mouth. I repent, Lord. I cancel those words. I render it powerless. I silence it in the Spirit. And I reverse it into blessings. And I prophesy resurrection power and life of the Holy Spirit to be blown over the seed in those prophetic promises. And we prophesy over those words. And we say, let the seeds be activated right now in the name of Jesus. Father, forgive me for not spending enough time with you to be able to hear your voice, to get revelation, get instructions for the direction I need to take in this new season. Lord, help me to come and seek your face once again. Awaken my heart with fresh fire to be hungry for you, to be desperate for you, and to be hungry for your word. I speak life and activation over those true words of God. And I connect my faith tonight afresh to it. Thank you, Lord, for the Holy Spirit that is breathing fresh resurrection power over those words. I open my heart tonight, Lord. I humble myself before you. I open my senses. And I ask you, Lord, to show me. And I receive. And I'm open to receive any new formula that you want to use in my life at this time to birth the new. I prophesy and I activate a new season over my life. And I speak to every dry and dead thing in my life. And I say, come alive. I say, God is doing a new thing. I prophesy over every dead, dry, and dormant area. I prophesy, receive new life. Come alive. And I say, Lord, right now, let your glory be revealed and be manifested in my life for what you're going to do, Lord. And I praise you for it. I give you praise. I give you thanksgiving. I give you honor for it. Let new faith arise. Let new hope arise. In Jesus' name, let's give the Lord a praise offering. Thank you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.